Hi, it's Mick Jagger here. It's a pleasure to be talking to everyone, the store managers and merchandisers. We're here to introduce this line of Rolling Stones clothing to you.
Because of their deep concern for their fans as far as style, quality, and value for the money, the band's involvement in this project has been extremely personal right from the start.
The conclusive proof of the Stones' moral and creative bankruptcy. The sight of the one-time satanic majesties turned into leisurewear salesmen.
It's very street, very tough, and like the band, it's all attitude.
What has set in is an incredible marketing cynicism.
And I hope you can have a lot of fun with the campaign. And I hope you like the clothes, I hope you wear the clothes, and I hope you have fun marketing them.
I think they were starting to market themselves. I mean, from the time that logo of that slavering mouth appeared in... They were the first pop group with a logo, probably the only pop group with a logo, a corporate image like that. Again, an interesting example of institutionalizing something sort of bad, you know, this slavering sort of cunnilingular sort of image, you know, everybody's wearing on their T-shirts. It's extraordinary, and it's a great marketing triumph, like the Double Diamond Man or something. But I suppose it really started in 1980 when they got Jovan perfume to give them a lot of money for printing the name Jovan on every concert ticket in America. It's pretty ironic, you know, that they were supposed to smell of fire and brimstone and then they smell of Jovan perfume. It's really horrible. Being sponsored by beer, a beer company, on their last tour was grotesque. I mean, how could they possibly need the money from sponsorship from a beer company when they have all the other millions they're going to make from that tour? It's quite monstrous.
For a long period during the 70s and early 80s, the Stones' implicit contempt for their material developed into an explicit contempt for their audience. Yet such was the strength of the Stones' myth that even this final betrayal worked in their favor. It became just another marketing strategy.
They tried as hard as they could to be as objectionable as they could, to treat the audience with as much contempt as they could, to be as greedy and gross and drunken and destructive as they possibly could. And somehow the more of this that they pulled out, the more it did good to them and did good to their image. They could be 3 or 4 hours late on stage, and the audience, for some reason, gave a kind of whipped shiver of delight the worse they were treated by the Rolling Stones.
For me, one of the most pathetic aspects of the Stones' long artistic twilight has been their refusal to shake off outdated songs and dinosaur attitudes. The fact that during the 80s they were still leaning heavily on 60s material was bad enough, but still to be performing such a crudely misogynistic piece as Under My Thumb showed a complete unwillingness to cope with changing times.
It's almost as though the Stones have been locked in a time capsule since their late 60s, early 70s heyday. How else could they think it was acceptable in the 80s to sing a line like, "Under my thumb, a squirming dog who's just had her day"? And not only do they show no awareness of the way in which society has changed, they also seem oblivious of the fact that all artists have to move on. Unlike other performers who emerged at the same time, they have shown no interest whatsoever in developing a late style.
Anyone who bumped into Van Morrison in the street would be unlikely to identify him as a rock star. In stark contrast to his exact contemporary, Mick Jagger, Morrison doesn't concern himself with personal vanity. Instead, he concentrates all his energies on music and regularly succeeds in reaching emotional heights the Stones haven't scaled in 20 years. Show me different shapes and colors. Show me many different roads. Give me very clear instruction. I was in the dark night of the soul. Another 60s survivor who has scorned easy popularity and searched within himself for new things is Lou Reed.
Pedro lives out of the Wilshire Hotel. He lives out a window without glass. The walls are made of cardboard. newspapers on his feet, and his father beats him because he's too tired to beg.
Reed's recent work has explored political, social, and ecological issues well outside the scope of the traditional pop song. It's hard to imagine the Stones doing the same. These days, they simply wouldn't know how.
But that's a slim chance. He's going to the boulevard.
Some critics greeted the Stones' recent tour as a belated return to form. For me, though, the admitted professionalism of their live shows only served to emphasize the band's total lack of anything new to say. Beneath a spectacular stage design lurked a continuing problem, style without substance.
They were dragging out those old songs, but somehow they were utterly drained of any meaning whatsoever, and they were rather grotesque. In fact, Mick Jagger reminded me rather of an old music hall comedian. He was a bit cross between Liberace and Danny LaRue in a way, sort of strutting around and seeming rather foolish. There wasn't any real meaning in what he did.
It was just like a sort of visible pension fund to me. Their horrible little bottoms, you know, still crammed into those hipster trousers. And they, Bill Wyman, who is going to be getting his state pension very soon, wears a bandana. That was the grotesque part of it to me.
It's very relaxed. All of it.
In August 1972, a 29-year-old Mick Jagger said, "When I'm 33, I'll quit and do something else. I can't say what it will be, but it won't be in showbiz." But showbiz is precisely where he's ended up. The Stones now seem incapable of artistic reinvention, content instead to churn out satisfaction like Sinatra churns out My Way. They have become what they set out to destroy. And that, in the words of the song that opens their 39th album, is sad, sad, sad.
You thought you were a clever girl, giving up your social world, but you can't come back, be the first in line. Oh no, you're obsolete, my baby, my poor old-fashioned baby. I said, baby, 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 you're out of time. Well, left out.